Hey, what's going on? In this video, I want to talk about the top three metal mixing mistakes that are keeping your mixes from sounding pro. And these are mistakes that I made for a long time in my mixes, and I see a lot of other people struggling with the same issues. And once I figured out these three things specifically, my mixes got a lot better. So what are they? Let's get started with number one. And the first metal mixing mistake that I used to make and that I see tons of people making out there is being too shy. What do I mean by that? Mostly I'm talking about EQ and just being too conservative with your levels in general. And you know, I see a lot of people out there talking about really being conservative with your moves. So whether that looks like limiting your EQ boost to only 3 dB max or 3 or 4 dB max, or maybe not boosting at all, like only cutting your EQ. Trust me, that is not gonna work for heavy music. I've got a lot of other video tutorials on my channel here, and you'll see me, whether it's drums or vocals, bass, whatever it is, really cranking the EQ sometimes when it's needed. I'm not saying you always have to crank up an EQ and be ridiculously aggressive, but you should be turning that knob or boosting that EQ, whatever it is, until it sounds the way you want it to sound. You don't have to limit yourself to certain rules or certain numbers. That might be boosting like 15 dB at 8K on a kick drum to get that top end click to cut through a mix. It could be adding 6 or 9 dB of mid-range around 1.5K to a bass guitar to get that really kind of grindy, aggressive bass tone. Whatever it is, if you're being shy, if you're being really conservative on your EQ moves, it's gonna hurt your mixes. They're gonna sound dull, lack energy, sound kind of lifeless. They just won't have that energy and edge that we all are used to hearing and like to hear for heavy music. Now, this mistake of being too shy also applies to just the general levels that you're using for everything. Now, there's a common misconception out there, it's kind of like a fad or hype or something, about using super low levels into your plugins, thinking that's gonna make them sound much better. And okay, maybe it might make your plugins sound cleaner if they're analog or if they're models of the old analog gear, but you gotta ask yourself, do you want things to sound super clean and clear? Remember, we're dealing with digital mixing now, and in the old days, we used to have tape and analog gear. It added a lot of its own harmonic distortion and its own character and vibe. So if we're trying to keep things super low and super clean, never pushing our plugins to the point where they're modeling that type of subtle distortion or maybe aggressive distortion, your mixes, again, they're gonna be kind of lifeless. They're not gonna have that kind of energy, and they're gonna lack that glue that really ties all the instruments together. I find you gotta push some plugins, you gotta add some distortion, you gotta push things to the point where they saturate a little bit so that you control dynamics and you get a little extra character and size in your mixes, and it helps glue everything together. So don't be too shy on your EQ or on your levels with some plugins, especially the ones that are modeling the old analog gear. You wanna push those sometimes and see what it sounds like, see if it gives you extra character and the extra energy and edge that you need in your mix. Okay, this idea of being too shy and too conservative, this leads us right into mistake number two, which is not using enough compression. Now, you might have seen some articles or tutorials out there that almost make compression sound bad, like kind of an evil thing that you should only use if it's really, really necessary. And this couldn't be further from the truth. I think when you first start out mixing, obviously you're using compression for mostly just level control. You wanna keep the vocal or the drum track or the bass, whatever it is, you wanna just eliminate the peaks and valleys of the sound and keep it a little bit more up front to control the level of it, right? But as you get more experienced in mixing, you'll find that compression is actually one of your best tools for creating energy, movement, and character and edge in your mixes. Using compression, you can enhance the attack of something to keep it way more up front and aggressive in the mix. You can also tone down the attack of something and have it sit further back in the mix. It's extremely powerful, but if you're only, again, being super conservative with your compression and not really using much of it, you're not gonna gain those benefits. One of the best examples of this is when you're mixing vocals. And you can check out my video on how to mix screen vocals here. It really demonstrates the compression aspect of this. But you'll see in that video, I'm absolutely slamming that vocal track with compression. By the time you add up all the compression from, you know, recording through the outboard compressor on the way in, to multiple plugins doing compression, you know, we're talking about 20, 30, maybe more dB of gain reduction. And again, at that point, you know, when you're doing that much gain reduction, it's not about the level control, all right? That's part of it, but it's really about the character. It's about squeezing every last drip of energy out of that singer's performance. And that's why compression is so powerful, and you don't wanna be too shy on it, especially on aggressive vocals like that. But I use it all over my mix, drums, bass, guitars, most things in my mix end up having compression. And remember, for heavy music, especially metal, hardcore and stuff, you know, we want loud, aggressive mixes most of the time. And in order to get something loud, you have to limit the dynamic range. And compression, you know, plays a huge part of that. And like I said, it also helps you shape the sound and add more character, add more edge, add more attack, aggression, all that great stuff. So definitely check out some of the other videos on my channel here to get more advice on exactly how to use that compression. Just don't be afraid. Just like I was saying with EQ, when it comes to compression, try not to look at the meter that's doing the gain reduction. Just try to look away or close your eyes, turn up that input knob or the threshold knob or whatever it is that's increasing the compression on that plugin, and just use your ears. Like, keep turning it up until you get the sound that you're going for, and then you can look at the meter. And because again, you're not mixing with your eyes here, we want to be mixing with our ears. So just put whatever you need on it to make it sound good. All right, the third metal mixing mistake that I see all the time and that I honestly struggled with for years is not having enough power in the low mids. Now, this is a tough one to get right, but I think it's really a signature of amateur mixes, is just having this hole in the low mids, usually, you know, around 100 or 150 hertz up to about 400. That area that actually most mixers, especially more on the beginner side, they're actually cutting that area, that low mid frequencies between, again, 150 and 400, scooping that out on a lot of tracks across your mix. And the reason most people are cutting these frequencies, these so-called muddy frequencies across almost every track in their mix, is because at first it sounds better. You know, it cleans up that kind of woofy, muddy sound. It allows you to hear the high end more clearly. It instantly sounds a little bit more hi-fi. But these frequencies where the mud lives, this is also where all of your power comes from, especially from the perspective of having your mix translate. So let me explain that. So a lot of us are trying to get all of our power in the low end from the sub frequencies. So anything below 100 hertz. So whether that's boosting, you know, 60 hertz, 80 hertz on a bass or a kick, whatever it is, we're trying to really beef up that sub low end that really like hits you in the chest, right? And you can feel it. And of course, that's great if you're listening on speakers or a system that can actually reproduce those frequencies well in an environment where they're not being really messed with or canceled out. But the thing is like, those frequencies are the hardest to get right in terms of translation. You know, if you're focusing on getting all of your low end power from those sub frequencies, what's gonna happen when someone's listening on a small speaker or in their car that doesn't have a subwoofer, or, you know, just in some other environment where they're not getting that low end very clearly or able to really feel that punch? So the problem is you beef up all those sub frequencies, you scoop the low mids, you boost the high mids and the high end in your studio, and it sounds great there. It sounds great when you're mixing, but then you take it out to the car or earbuds or some other type of speaker to listen on, and all of a sudden your mix sounds thin. It's just lacking power. It just has this hole in the middle of it in the low mids, and you're wondering, you know, why isn't this hitting hard? Why isn't this sounding as full as it did back in my studio? Again, this was my problem for literally years, probably 3 to 5 years. I struggled with this over and over and over. It was super frustrating, but I ended up solving this issue in three ways. So number one is to mix on smaller speakers. Now, honestly, you'll see my NS10s behind me here. Once I started mixing on those, this problem shifted very quickly. And here's the reason. These things don't really reproduce sub frequencies below 100 hertz very well. It trails off very quickly. I can't hear really, you know, 60 hertz. So what does that do? That forced me to focus on getting low end power out of higher frequencies, those low mids that we're talking about between 100 and 400 hertz. And because I wasn't obsessing over the sub and only focusing on those really low frequencies when it came to low end, I was getting more power in my mixes, and they just started translating way, way better. Why? Because pretty much all speakers are going to be able to reproduce those low mid frequencies. So mixing on bigger speakers or having a subwoofer that gives you a lot of that low end sub energy, it kind of gives you the illusion that you have a really big, powerful low end, but really all you have is just a bunch of sub information, and you might have a huge hole and no power when it comes to translation in your mixes. The second thing that helped me overcome this issue was to stop using solo. And like I said, when you hear a sound in solo, pretty much any instrument sounds better when you cut the low mids. Like, just pull up any drum track, a bass track, a heavy guitar track, even a vocal. Go at 300 hertz, scoop it out. You're gonna think it sounds better, at least at first. But again, when you add all this up, if you're doing that across everything in your mix, you're gonna have a huge hole and no power. So stop listening in solo and stop mixing in solo, and you're gonna make a lot less unnecessary cuts, and you're gonna retain a lot of that energy and power in your mixes. Finally, the third thing that really helped me overcome this problem with lacking power in my mixes was just to stop cutting low mids. Like literally, that's what I did. I had identified this problem. I identified that when I compared Pro mixes to mine, I had this hole in the low mids and I was lacking power in those so-called muddy frequencies. At first it was really weird. Like my mixes, I thought sounded kind of muddy, kind of woofy. I wasn't sure about it, but I stuck with that commitment I made to myself just to see what would happen. And lo and behold, I would take it out for the car test or listen somewhere else and it translated way better. I had way more power in my mixes. And so I just got used to that. And these days, if you look at my mixes, it's pretty rare to see any cuts between, let's say, 150 and 400, 500 hertz. Now I just like to leave all that how it is in the source sound, to try and keep all of that power intact in my mixes. The only thing that doesn't really apply to is drums. Obviously with kick, toms, and even cymbals and stuff, I scoop out a lot of those low mids. But when you're talking about guitars, bass, extra layers, and vocals, I just leave it all in there. I mean, sometimes I'm even now boosting in those frequencies. Like, can you imagine boosting 400 hertz on a guitar track or a bass? Not very common, not something you see very often. But again, this is where the power and the low end that actually translates, that's where it's coming from. So if you have this same problem, I encourage you to start mixing on smaller speakers so you're not obsessing over the sub, and then stop mixing in solo so much. And then number three, just try literally not cutting those frequencies in your mixes. All right, so those are the top three metal mixing mistakes that I used to make and that I see other people making, other up and coming mixers. And again, they are being too shy in your EQ and your levels, not using enough compression, and number three, losing all the power in the low mids. If you start to solve those issues using the tips I gave you in this video, you'll start to hear your mixes rapidly progressing from that amateur kind of sound to something that sounds a lot more pro, something that can compete with mixes done by your favorite mixers. If you want to go deeper on this stuff, I've got a free web class available right now, a free mixing webinar, and you can click the link below in the description here to sign up. And that's going to help you take all of these ideas we just talked about and actually start implementing them. Take it to the next level so you can actually see in action how to use this stuff in your mixes. I want to help you get out of that frustrating basement demo quality land where all of your stuff kind of sounds like that and start getting to the point where you can be cranking out mixes that actually sound competitive and sound professional. So again, register for that free web class below while it's available. Otherwise, make sure you subscribe to this channel for more tutorials, and we'll talk soon.